The CEO Hour with Dean Akers. The mission? To help CEOs and startups succeed in today's marketplace. Entrepreneur or established CEOs, is your business growing? Where is your business going? Let's talk about it with your host, Dean Akers.
Well, welcome to the CEO Hour. I'm your host, Dean Akers, each week bringing you top CEOs or people in the industries that can influence and help you be more successful. And kind of, they'll share their journeys, but the cool thing is they'll share what worked right, but they'll also share what didn't work right. We've had some really cool guests over the last month or two. We had Chris Sullivan, which has just blown up. A lot of the listeners out there have loved that. Next week, we have the former mayor of Tampa, Florida, Bob Buckhorn. But today, we're really blessed to have Chris Krimitsos on, and I've known Chris for a number of years. He's a total mover and shaker in the Tampa Bay area, but he has the vision to be able to really show people how to grow their businesses. And so, Chris, welcome.
Hey, Dean, thanks for having me on the platform.
Well, one of the things our listeners really love, and everybody comes on here wanting to talk about what they do, but we never start out there. We got to start out back in September of 78.
You had my birthday down. Yeah. That's good. Yeah.
So what happened in September 78?
Well, September of 78, my mom had just moved from Greece to the U.S. My dad plucked her out of a village. I believe she was the virgin that he found. And I was born in Syosset, New York, September 23rd, 1978.
And that's Long Island area,
Long
right?
Long Island, yep.
Yeah, so you grew up in Long Island.
Yeah.
And so your parents are true Greek immigrants.
Yeah. My first language was actually Greek because my mom didn't know English yet. And then
really?
She learned English by doing my homework, and I learned delegation. So that was my first entrepreneurial lesson.
Can you still speak Greek?
Oh, yeah. Oh, my in-laws always, when we went to Greece, they're like, it was like a flip switch. They never see me speak Greek. Like, we had no idea. Like, they had a whole different respect for me.
That's awesome. So you grew up in Long Island, and you went to school in Long Island. Where'd you go to college?
Well, I went to three, so I never graduated. College wasn't, I was like at 8 years old, I knew I was going to be an entrepreneur. And the reason is Robert Kiyosaki had rich dad, poor dad. I had poor dad, rich uncles. And the interesting thing for me is my dad was the most educated of the bunch. And my one uncle, hand to God, he would sign with an X. He couldn't sign in Greek or English. He didn't know any of the languages. And he was a self-made millionaire that then propelled the other three. And then two of the brothers, they weren't as successful. So as a young kid, it kind of made me scratch my head like, if my dad's the most educated, like he's like a genius engineer. I'm talking about mathematical, like genius. And my uncles are not the smartest people in the world. And yet they're the one with the house with the cabana and the pool and all this stuff. There's got to be some clues here. So I'm very inquisitive. So obviously, I asked a lot of questions. And one day my uncle George, who took me aside, he goes, do you think we were just born successful? And I go, yeah. I was a kid. What I know? He goes... And he started telling me how they came here with nothing, literally went broke multiple times. And then there was a pivot point in their history where they were about to close up shop. And the food critic for Newsday, which anyone that knows Long Island, that was the paper record, came in. They had already decided, listen, guys, if nothing changes in a month from now, we're putting the keys in the place. Food critic came in like a week later, wrote a full page, and they had a line out the door. And from that point on, they became self-made millionaires, but it was years in the making.
But I think there's a message there for our listeners, because people think you fall out of the womb a self-made millionaire. Your uncles had the tenacity to stay with it, right?
Not only tenacity, yes, because they made a lot of mistakes when they...
Yeah, that's what I'm
when
saying.
They became, even before and after, it took them like 10, 15 years to figure out how to manage money. Because remember, they were poor... villagers, literally goat herders. You know, it's a funny thing, but they came from tending the fields. Overnight, their restaurant had a line out. I remember the analogy was that line was out till 8 p.m., then 10 p.m., then 11 p.m., till 1 a.m. there was a line out the door of their restaurant. So they also then had to learn how to manage money and wealth. And they did. I mean, they went through a lot of money before they figured that out, but each of my three uncles, one was very financially sound from the get-go. My uncle Gus learned on the way, and so did my uncle George, and it was interesting to watch them learn how to manage money.
Well, that had to be a huge education for you.
It was, because my uncles loved me, and they always took care of me. And at 13, my dad brought me in. My dad worked the kitchen, so he was offered a a job at IBM to be a head engineer. And the gentleman said to him, "We'll put you in charge of the crew once your English gets better." All my dad heard was "when your English gets better." And sometimes people just look for the things they want to hear. And he never went back to IBM. And he wound up working for his brothers in the restaurant, which is really a unique story. But long story short, one day my dad brought me in at 13 to go work with my Uncle Gus. And my Uncle Gus was very imposing. He was the patron, you know, of the family. And at the end of my shift, he gave me $50, which was a lot of money back then. And he goes, "Never come back here again." And I was like, wow, what a really mean person. You know, I was dishwashing. My hands were, he would make me put my hands through the steam so you'd get singed by the heat. And he said, "You're not quick enough." And he followed up those words, though, at the end there with something that changed my life forever. He said, "Listen, I saw you talk to the customers during lunchtime." He goes, "You have a gift. You have the ability to communicate with people and make them feel special." He said, "You go to school, develop that gift. If after you go to school and learn English and your letters," he goes, "when I was a kid, I wasn't allowed to go past, I think, 9 years of age. My grandfather took him out of school." He said, "I didn't have that advantage. I want you to have that." He goes, "And if you want to come back to the diner, I will invite you with open arms. But until then, I don't want to see you back here again." Changed my life forever.
Wow. Yeah. So was his message was learn, but not necessarily book learn, just be inquisitive.
His message was, listen, this life, the restaurants, is a tough life. He goes, "You could do business," but this is what he said to me. He goes, "I see these business guys that come into the restaurant." Remember, this is New York. These people were on Wall Street.
Right.
And he goes, "I hear the conversations. They're making millions." So he just knew there was other ways, professionally, whatever you want to call it, much easier than working a restaurant where they're all working around the clock. Even when they have shifts, you're worried about people stealing food out the back door. You know, there's so many ways to lose money in the restaurant industry. He just knew it was a tougher life. So he was like, "Hey, develop your skills. You know how to talk to people. You could be sales or you could do something with it." So he just knew there was a better opportunity for me. And he wanted better because my grandfather never gave him that opportunity. He pulled him. My uncle was very big as a child. So my grandfather took him out of school so he could work the fields. So he was always very resentful that he was never allowed to develop because he loved learning. So he had to learn the hard way.
So did they come over? Did your grandfather come over and bring them? Or did they?
My Uncle Gus got in a fight with my grandfather for obvious reasons. They did not get along. Because he wanted more out of life. And he literally worked the merchants, a marine, in the ships. For those who don't know, Greece is huge in the ship industry. And he literally jumped ship, not very popular to say today, but back then, he was in New York Harbor, left all the money on the ship so people would think he'd come back, took $20, jumped ship, called his friend on a payphone. Luckily, his friend was at the diner because my uncle didn't know how to speak English. I don't even know how he wrote because my uncle can't write, but he somehow wrote the symbols together to where to go. And he took a cab with that last $20, and then he would work 18 hours a day. My uncle was known for, back then, he would work a double shift, and then you had like 6 hours off. So instead of taking the bus, which even everybody said back then was like 10 cents, like, it was so cheap. He would walk home for an hour and a half, and then so he'd only sleep an hour. So they all knew him as a crazy man, and he saved enough money in the late 1960s. Put that money on a penny stock, had no idea about stocks, but it tripled, and used that money to put a down payment on his first restaurant.
Wow. Wow. Is he still alive?
He is. Uncle Gus is 80 years old, makes his own homemade wine. And
he's got to be
a character. He's a character.
He's a guy you need to have on one of your podcasts.
He's hard of hearing, unfortunately. One of his early jobs back then, he also worked at an airport. And they didn't wear protective gear on the runway.
No.
So he can't hear, unfortunately. But he's, I've tried to thank him, tell him how much he means to me. He just kept saying, "What do you say?" You know, he can't hear.
So do you still have any communication with him?
Oh, yeah. We go up there and see him. Sometimes he could hear. Depends. But he is the patriarch of our family. He brought his siblings over and then paid for everybody. He always looked at my dad as someone smarter than him, wanted the best for my dad. But my dad wanted to work with his brothers.
So did your dad meet your mom here, or did...
He literally went back to Greece and plucked her out of the village. You know, it was like one of those...
Oh, my goodness.
he was enjoying his life here as a bachelor, and somewhere in his 30s, he went back and got the 19-year-old out of the village.
So no, I got it. This is one of them. Everybody thinks entrepreneurs just fall out of the womb successful with no journey. You're Uncle Gus, your dad, all those things are part of your DNA, aren't they?
They are. So that's what I learned. I knew I was going to be an entrepreneur at 8 years old. And this is before it was like a sexy topic. I just knew, based on what I saw, that's what I was going to be. So I went to college. It's going to be very interesting. I went to college to learn what I wanted to study, but I never got a degree. I have more than enough credits for a degree. I didn't do it for that. So actually, I would take really weird classes. Philosophy. I would take directing, 303. I would skip the 201, 101, or whatever. So I just took whatever would expand my horizons because I already knew I was going to be an entrepreneur.
Well, you know, Chris, that's epic that you saw that young. And a lot of people don't understand. I was at the University of Tampa recently, and I was talking about it. And 20 years ago, the word entrepreneur was a cuss word.
Right.
I mean, it was bad. So, you know, I want to remind everybody that if they want the three circle sales tips, all they got to do is go at help@adjunctceo.com. That's help@adjunctceo.com. We've got a lot of listeners that have been requesting that. We've been shipping it out. I've got people really getting a hold of the sales program that's really helping their business. Again, we're here every week bringing you top CEOs and business people that can share their journeys. This week we have Chris Krimitsos, and you know, he's going to share more about Uncle Gus and his transition into entrepreneurship. We'll be right back with more of Chris Krimitsos.
The CEO Hour with your host, Dean Akers. Connect with Dean at deanakers.com. We'll be right back.
So, you're a tech startup. You're working hard, trying to make it happen with big ideas, big dreams, and a small budget. You need to connect with people in the same boat. Now is the time to join the early stage startup group, the Innovation Center, an incubator for early stage tech firms. You can find them at tbinnovates.com. Now operating for over 14 years, the Innovation Center is a regional, national, and internationally known success story, continuing to generate momentum in Pinellas County. Twice, the Innovation Center has won the Tampa Bay Technology Forum's Excellence in Service Award and has been recognized by Entrepreneur.com as a top 10 international business incubator. And now, Tech Garage, a technology and entrepreneurship center, has joined forces with the Innovation Center to provide a co-working program in downtown St. Petersburg. Connect with the startup community. Connect with the Innovation Center. Go to tbinnovates.com. That's tbinnovates.com. And tell them the Adjunct CEO sent you.
If you're a CEO or organizational leader looking to expand your business, join the CEO Council, where you'll meet and exchange ideas with fellow CEOs without the pressures of a sales network environment. You can join today by sending an email to application@adjunctceo.com. The CEO Council is comprised of over 220 fantastic local business leaders you'll be able to learn from because they walk in your shoes every day. When you become a member of the CEO Council, you'll have an opportunity to build trusted relationships during the roundtable meetings, share your triumphs, vet ideas, and work through business challenges with peers who can provide real-world business solutions. The CEO Council offers opportunities to hear from world-renowned speakers that inspire ideas to help members grow as both leaders and individuals. Join the CEO Council. Request your CEO Council membership application today at adjunctceo.com or by sending email to application@adjunctceo.com. That's application@adjunctceo.com.
Helping your business succeed in today's marketplace. Welcome back to the CEO Hour with Dean Akers.
Welcome back to the CEO Hour. Again, I'm your host, Dean Akers, bringing you top CEOs or leaders every week that share their journeys. This week, we have Chris Krimitsos, who in the first segment was sharing some really cool stuff. I mean, I can't even imagine, Chris, your dad and his brother and their journey jumping off a ship and then really they're the ultimate immigrant, ultimate entrepreneurs then.
Yeah, not only that, but they always had the best stories, because if you think of like leaving a country without knowing a language and then going to another one, and they're not restricted by conventional wisdom, because they've already bucked conventional wisdom and left everything behind. So it's the ultimate risk, you know.
Did that, when you've talked with them now as in growing up, did they? And this is funny. In today's era, you hear all this stuff, all this rhetoric on the various media sources about the U.S. and how bad, you know, we don't have opportunities and stuff. They were in another country, and they made a choice to come here. What was it? What were they hearing? And would they say today that the American dream is still alive?
Oh, yeah. All they saw was opportunity. You know, they came, they left a country that, you know, a lot of people don't realize, but after World War II, my uncles and my dad and his brothers, they lived under a, I think it was a military junta is what they call it. So military regime, five generals took over Greece, and they had to fight off communists after that. So you have to understand, there was no stability. They grew up in the fields. And I remember asking, because the village they lived, they grew up in, is a mountain that cascades into the ocean. And it's beautiful. The Ionian Sea, one of those beautiful seas in the Mediterranean. And I asked them, how come you guys didn't build homes down on the water? Because I'm thinking, like, you should own waterfront property, right? And then some guy's like, he goes in Greek, he goes, the pirates. I'm like, what the heck's a pirati? And then I realized he's saying the pirates. I go, what pirates? They go, back then in the 50s, 60s, pirates go rape your children and your wives, take all your stuff and burn your house down. So they lived up on the top of the mountain so they could be ready to defend themselves. This is the kind of life that they lived. And I'm talking my dad and his brother. Right. We're not talking like
some old movie.
I'm a fairly young guy. Yeah, like so they had to live under like all these weird things, worried about their well-being, living up on these fields. So America was the land of opportunity, and then they saw it. I'll tell you what the Greek community in New York would say. They'd always model after the Jewish community. They're like, hey, we need to be more like the Jewish community. And you say, why is that? They go, because what people don't realize is a lot of those restaurants that the Greeks took over, and the Italians, they bought from the Jews. The Jews had the delicatessens. They had all these great places. But the Jewish community then, they took the money, and they really helped their kids and the youth go into the legal, the professional, the Wall Street, all that stuff. And the Greeks did the same thing. They said, we want you to be successful the way the Jewish community is successful. And they put all their love and TLC into their kids to go into the city of Manhattan and make a name for themselves. If you ever look at politics, you'll always see Greek names pop up. That's a big deal, you know, whether it was Paul Tsongas, Dukakis, Stephanopoulos.
Yeah.
You're like, why do all these Greek names pop up? It's a big thing in the Greek community that, you know, you want your kid to be successful. You want him to go into politics, into the legal profession, into, you know, money management, whatever it is that, you know, it's most of them don't want their kids growing up in the restaurants because it's a very tough life.
Well, you know, that's interesting. And so now you've kind of figured this out. You're living in Long Island. What in the world or what took you on your journey to come south?
So that's funny. My dad and I butted heads, and I wanted to move here. One of the things I really enjoyed is I used to breed parrots, believe it or not. And Florida, Tampa Bay, is one of the largest amalgamation of parrot breeders in the country. So I moved.
Now we've eclipsed the show. Our show is always about everybody having at least one thing they have as a takeaway.
Yeah.
Now that everybody has a takeaway, they can turn the radio off right now. So is that true?
Honest to God, yeah. I don't talk about it at all. So one of my passions was I love birds, right? So my dad at the time had gotten prostate cancer, and I went with him. We caught it very early, so I knew he was going to be okay. But, you know, anyone that hears the C word, they tune out everything that the doctor says. But the doctor was telling me, it's like almost 100% where he's at, radical cells, blah, blah, blah. So in the moment, I said, Dad, I'd love to breed parrots in the house. Well, he thought he was going to die. So he's like, you could do that, right? So while he has the surgery, I literally had a pathfinder at the time. I went down to Florida, went to all these captive breeding places, bought 500 birds, built the cages in the basement.
You bought 500?
500 birds. Built an entire breeding facility in the basement, right, with my buddy. You know, everybody has like a best friend that will support you.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I'm building cages out in the front. My dad now, he can't make it down the stairs because of the prostate surgery. 6 months later, he's doing better. You can hear him hobbling down the stairs. And then I can't say what he said, but he was like, what the, you know, really loud. I was like, what happened? He goes, when did you have time? It was only 6 months. But when you're passionate about something, you know, you make it happen. So he basically gave me an ultimatum. And I took him up on that, and then I sold those birds, and I moved to Florida.
Was his ultimatum, we won't use the Greek words, and we're not going to use the words on the radio.
Well, you could imagine.
Yeah, it wasn't like.
It was the birds, or, yeah.
Yeah, so you sold these birds. See, I had no idea.
So I moved down here thinking I was going to breed birds. And
so wait a minute, so now you leave Long Island.
I leave Long Island with all my possessions in we bought one of those big box trucks, the old Grumman trucks. It was a whole nother journey to get down here. It took like 3 days. We broke down multiple times.
And we would be?
Me and my best buddy.
Your best
buddy. Who helped me build the cages. And my neighbor.
Was he thrown out of his family?
No, he was already like, you know, he was already an independent child, right? But he's like, oh, let's go Florida. My dad always loved it down there, you know. So I had bought a house in Holiday, Florida. I was a serial entrepreneur. So the last iteration before I left Long Island, I was a general contractor. So I learned how to do vinyl. I didn't know how to do any of it. I learned how to do the sales and run the business of it. Vinyl siding, roofing, and windows. We hit $1 million our first 13 months in business. Me and a old-timer business guy that needed structure.
Down here?
No, in Long Island.
Oh.
So I had enough money where I was buying homes down here in Holiday. They were going really cheap. So I bought half a dozen homes down here. And then I moved. I decided I don't want to breed birds because it just wasn't.
But did you decide that in the truck or when you got here?
When I got here, I was like, you know what? I think I'll put this on the back burner. At the time, real estate was hot in Florida. I was like, hey, this real estate thing, I thought I was a genius. You know, you buy a house and they double. This was in 05, 06.
Oh, you were right front side of that wave.
Now, here I got really lucky because I bought my homes in Holiday. I thought that was Tampa. So I had no kids, so I was doing no research. My other uncle Jimmy lived on Gulf Harbor's on the water. So I was like, this is where Tampa is. So I liquidated all six homes before the market crashed because I wanted to relocate to the city of Tampa. So I got very lucky. I had time and money.
Oh, you should go buy a lotto ticket tonight.
Well, I was not a genius because I know the way I like to risk things. I didn't land in the right place. I needed to. So anyways, I was in Tampa. I rented for the first time. No one would rent to me because I was in my mid to late 20s. I had no rental references because I lived with my parents, bought my own house. No one believed I owned my own home. So I had to make up rent. I had to have a friend make up that they were my rental reference. I really don't like lying. So I found a little place in South Tampa, and I started producing public access TV shows. One was called Millionaire Mindset, and the other one was called The Bleepin' Truth, which is a political debate show. And in that process, while I was producing those two shows, I realized I really like business people. I like helping them. And that's when I created the community that became the Tampa Bay Business Owners.
Well, before we go to break for the second segment, I got to ask you, how in the world do you get in a truck driving down here, going to be a bird guy, then get in the house business, and then go to broadcast? Where did that come from?
So the gentleman, my neighbor, who helped me move, he was a New York City firefighter.
When is this the guy that got in the truck with you?
Yeah. Well, my best friend, Aaron, right? Yeah. Same age, you know, young kids, 20s. My neighbor was late 40s.
Oh, okay.
His kids are grown up. But he helped me move down 2 months after he passed away. So it was losing my father figure because my neighbor was always around. So it set me on a different course. So that was why everything shifted. And one of the goals I always wanted in life was to leave an impact and inspire people to be the best version of themselves.
Right.
And that's how I started those TV shows.
Well, that really begs the question for our listeners out there to follow your passion then.
Yeah, when he passed away, it changed all my priorities overnight. I know you hear about these things, and I don't talk about it. It was extremely painful for me. I joined Big Brothers that week. The lady asked me, why'd you join? I didn't realize how impactful he was. You know, I broke down in tears. He was, because he was the firefighter dad, he was always around. Because they're 3 days on, 4 days off, and vice versa. So he always did everything for the neighborhood kids, and he'd always help people. So I believe that when people say you always love helping people, I don't think about it. I think it was modeled off of being around a mentor that had a scanner in his car, and all he would do is help people 24/7, on top of being born into a big, fat Greek family where everybody supports each other. So it was doubly, it was weird. It was doubly enforced for me. And then at home, my parents were working, so I'd watch Oprah, and she was going through her own transformation. So between those three things, I think I have a very big desire to help others.
Well, Chris, I mean, the reason I love having folks like you on the show is because as you start opening in your journey, the message out there is clear that you, when you start following your passion was obviously helping people.
Yeah.
You had a whole role model guy that really taught you that. You came down here with your passion original with birds and houses and everything else. So, listen, I'm just so excited, and we're going to be talking to you more in segment three about this because I think helping people is part of the messaging coming out of the CEO Hour. So we'll see. We'll get back with you in segment three.
helping established CEOs and entrepreneurs. Connect with Dean at deanakers.com. The CEO Hour continues in a moment. Helping to navigate today's marketplace for startups and mainstays. Welcome back to the CEO Hour with Dean Akers.
Well, welcome back to the CEO Hour. Again, I'm your host, Dean Akers, bringing you top business leaders in each week that share their journeys, the goods and the bads. And this week we have Chris Krimitsos on. And I got to tell you, the first two segments have been very powerful. To transition, to follow your passion, and to have an influencer like that that really sets you on a course of helping people and putting that as a passion, and then to take that, move to Tampa or the Tampa Bay area, and then get down here and have all the fortuitous thing. I'm a big believer, Chris, that things happen for a reason. Do you believe in that?
I do, because when my neighbor passed away, you and I are probably very similar. I like set, even Katie says, she goes, you set intentions out and things just happen. And I follow my life that way. So even I don't know how it's going to happen. I just know I'm moving through the paces and it happens. But when my neighbor passed away, I wanted to help people, and TV was one of the ways I could do it. But I lived in Pasco County. The only two public accesses in the area were Hillsborough and Pinellas. So a friend of mine, I had just moved to Florida. He invited me over his house. He goes, listen, you better behave. We have a Greek Orthodox priest coming over. So he was just trolling me. You know, of course, I start cursing at him. He's like, don't do that when the priest is over. So he was just getting a rise out of me. Turned out the priest was a USF professor. He also had a desire to do live TV shows, and he sponsored. He wrote a letter. I didn't know a soul, and got me into public access in Tampa. And I was able to start my TV career within a week of writing it down on a piece of paper through tears as I lost my neighbor.
Oh, wow.
So I don't, there's, you have to have faith and believe that, you know, kind of like, I always say like Indiana Jones, you got to put that first foot out there. So I live my life like that. So that's, that was a very big moment in my life.
So this is public access through cable TV.
Yeah, TBCN was the channel back then. It was channel 19 and 20.
Right.
We started The Bleepin' Truth, which was a political debate show, which I had a lot of fun with. That one became famous because Joe Redner had a chair thrown at him on live TV, and I had to break up both parties. And it went viral all around the world and back, literally. The janitor, who only spoke Spanish, knew about the clip the next day. He had seen it on Telemundo and Univision, you know. And then the other one was Millionaire Mindset, which I enjoyed much more. Because it was business owners, how they thought, how they built their businesses. And you learn a lot by looking at all these different personalities. You know, some traits are not desirable for me. Other traits, you know, you see certain people like... I always liked... you were always one of my favorite CEOs, and probably Ed DeRosti, two people, one of the co-founders of Hooters, because they always put their relationships first, and that always fit well with me. Then you get other CEOs that, you know, they'll burn, slash and burn everybody in front of them to get what they want. It's just not and as a young man, I'm trying to figure out what works. And you find the people that you like the style of what they do and how they do it. And you pick what, I call it, a friend of mine used to call it functionalizing your art form. We have to functionalize our art form. So I had to figure out what is Chris Krimitsos' art form and how do I want to functionalize that. So it was creating the Tampa Bay Business Owners for me was a great education. An education you can't even pay for, because I was able to meet all these amazing CEOs and then expose them to hundreds of business owners in the local area. So it was phenomenal learning.
Yeah, so you're doing this public access show. How do you morph into creating the Tampa Bay Business Owners Group?
So it's very interesting. We got in trouble with the Bleepin' Truth because of that chair thing. So put us on the sites of the management. They didn't like certain things we were doing. And we were really pushing the envelope. Now it's par for the course. But you're talking 10 years ago. It was very ahead of its time. We'd give everybody equal access. But long story short, that kind of put us on a thing. And I said, you know, I don't want someone controlling what I can and cannot say. Even though it's public access, there's still a group of people involved. And this is in the infancy of YouTube. So YouTube hadn't... It just started a year prior to that. So I said to my team, I said, I don't want to be limited to someone else for my success. So I sent out an email. Back then, we had an opt-in. No one knew what it was. It was at the very bottom of my page. 300 people were excited to put their emails in. We emailed them out, and we said, hey, we're thinking of starting a group. We'd love to tell you about it. And 99 people showed up, believe it or not. And I targeted business owners that go to meetings, because I figured a business owner that never went to a meeting is very tough to convert. But a business owner that goes to meetings will come to mind.
Right.
So we started back then. I pitched them this idea of a group of business owners helping each other up the ladder of success. 20 people signed on. And then we went from 20 to 80, 80 to 160 to 300 yearly members. I mean, we were the largest in the area. Most of our business owners were under $1 million in revenue. Most people classify as startups, but these were the business community of Tampa Bay. So it was very rewarding to then do the live interviews in front of them. If you think about the live main event, that's a live produced show. That's I learned that from the TV shows.
Right. And you invited me to come in a number of years ago and visit.
Yeah, you've spoken how many times there?
Yeah. And I get so turned on because what happens is you really have people that are business owners that you're really helping. And it's part of your give back. And I know it's the foundation of who you are. So the Tampa Bay Business Owners has kind of been rocking along, and it grew. And you've been doing that for, what, 10, 12 years?
10 years, and then I sold it a couple years ago. The gentleman that I sold it to, unfortunately, didn't understand the commitment it took to keep it going. And then I took it back over from him. So now we still have it going on, but not as frequently as it was going. So now we have a couple events a year, but back then we used to do 150 events a year.
Yeah, I think it's probably, you know, I'm sure as we're going to visit with our entrepreneurs, I'll hear some more of your journey, but I would say that that was a great platform that probably should still live on. And, you know, when we get off air, we might want to talk about that because I do believe it's a great platform for young entrepreneurs. So now you're sitting there rocking along, the Tampa Bay Business Owners is going, and you get a bug. What caused this bug? Does it go all the way back to public access? How did you find out?
Yeah, so that bug was always there, public access. So the mass communication has always been something I'm good at.
Yeah.
So when I did Tampa Bay Business Owners, that restricted me to a live audience, and it wasn't. We were testing with YouTube, but I never spent enough time to understand YouTube or podcasting. And in early 09, late 09, I brought in Gary Vaynerchuk, who now is a top entrepreneur guy in the world. Back then, no one knew who he was. And I had to give people his book, Crush It, for them to read it before he showed up so they knew who the speaker was. And we had 150 people show up for him. And I remember,
what was his feedback, man?
There wasn't no fee. I bought 400 books. No one knew who he was. Literally, he had a wine blog.
Yeah, I knew he did.
Yeah, so I had to educate people, and I put censored because he was the watershed moment. If you talk about people changing the way business is done, before him, very rarely did speakers even curse. After him, now it's common, but before that, you would never get invited back to platforms. So he changed the entire landscape of speaking from the Zig Ziglar, Tony Robbins days. No, Tony was the young gun for those guys,
right.
But it still was all established. Gary Vee literally blew up the model and created a new model. And I remember seeing him, and at the time I knew I wanted to be an influencer, but I really was having a lot of fun growing my own community, geo-local. But I said to myself, whenever the next opportunity comes around, I'm going to be aware that it's a national, international opportunity, not a local. Because I was teaching social media in 09. I didn't realize I could have taught a whole country instead of just the people in Tampa. And I should have realized that when people from Naples and Jacksonville were driving every week to learn these lessons. I was teaching at the Village Inn on Humphreys and Dale Mabry. So one of the guys at Mimi's at the time in Lumsden Road in Brandon, we had all these little meetups. He's talking about podcasting. I said, how many people do you have? I had just spent a whole month promoting 12 people to come to this meetup. After he was done, I said, how many people listen to your show? And he talked about Android apps. That's all the show was about. He goes, 4,000. I go, is that a year? Is that a week? He goes, no, every week. I go, how many shows you do a week? He goes, one. I go, you have 4,000 people listening to what you have to say out of your house? And he thought I was judging him. He goes, yeah, I know. I'm trying to get the number up. I go, no, dude. I just spent a whole month getting 12 people in front of you. Do you not understand how valuable 4,000 people? So I went home and told my wife, I'm starting a podcast. She goes, about what? I go, I don't know. I'm just so excited. I'm like you. I got so excited. I'm just doing a podcast. I don't know what it is. She goes, but I want to do one too. And we had a really great business consultant said, listen, you guys are doing 150 events. You both can't start a podcast. You don't even know what's into starting one. So we decided, my wife wanted to be the podcaster for female voices. I did the research. There was only one other show. So I was like, she'd be a pioneer. She'd be a revolutionary. I said, I'll be your marketing manager. I'll get the psychic benefits. We launched her to number one. She has literally now inspired thousands of women the world over. And I knew she needed resources. So we started a local group called the Florida Podcast Association. out of that, we started a conference called Podfest. And Podfest has doubled in size year over year now for 6 years. We're expecting close to 2,000 people next year.
So your wife did Biz Women Rock or whatever, if I remember right, right?
Yeah.
And did she get a lot of downloads?
You know, the numbers were, they were so big, they were tough to imagine at the time. It was like 20,000, almost out of the gate.
Right.
Because there was nothing out there. She had 5,000 people in a Facebook group shortly thereafter. Took her a couple years to build up to it. But she took her a year or two before she monetized because she didn't believe she had the value. But my wife is so sharp, I always told her, you know. So she started mentoring and consulting women the world over from this podcast.
That's epic. So now we're going to go into the final segment, and we're just getting through the crazy parts of the journey too, because just real briefly, give us a real brief on the movie. We've got about 50 seconds till we go into segment four.
Which movie?
Oh, you got more than one?
Oh,
the Messenger.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay,
that's the movie.
Yeah,
we may save that for segment four.
We'll tell segment four. I'll tell you the movie. We had a couple others that never worked, and then the Messengers all came together. Yeah.
So you've had this crazy journey. Well, so let me just say this. I want to reach out to our entrepreneurs out there. We're going to go into segment four in a second, but I want to share with you. If you need anything on sales tips, remember we have the Three Circle program. You can get it at help@adjunctceo.com. That's help@adjunctceo.com. And we're going to be right back with more with Chris Krimitsos talking about his movie career.
Success never takes the weekend off. Connect with Dean at deanakers.com. The CEO Hour continues in a moment.
Growth begins by understanding where you are now. For a limited time, business growth experts at Adjunct CEO will provide a full CEO physical of your business valued at $10,000 for free. Email CEOphysical@adjunctceo.com. This offer includes financial, marketing, and sales analysis and an outline to help you strategize future success. For your free CEO physical, email CEOphysical@adjunctceo.com. CEOphysical@adjunctceo.com.
Florida ranks high as a new hub for business growth and innovation. Startups, restarts, and starting over are all part of the new vitality generated as geography and economic opportunity collide. As Florida's entrepreneurial ecosystem grows, many are using Synapse to grow their business. Synapse is a groundbreaking methodology that connects all personas within the innovation economy, utilizing a method that enables all users to progress in meeting their given needs while promoting much-needed community engagement. Never more than now has Florida presented opportunity to be better aligned in business, providing huge potential for greater overall results with strong collaboration and holistic leadership. Synapse is a growth synthesis platform that will allow you to take advantage and flourish in ways you never thought possible as an entrepreneur, as a business, and within the context of community, events, connections, publishing, all with Synapse. See for yourself at SynapseFL.com. That's SynapseFL.com.
Helping your business succeed in today's marketplace. Welcome back to the CEO Hour with Dean Akers.
Well, welcome back to the CEO Hour. Again, I'm Dean Akers, your host, bringing you top CEOs or entrepreneurs in the Tampa Bay area, and quite frankly, all over, that share their journey, the goods, the bads, and things they've learned along the way. Today, we have Chris Krimitsos, and wow, I've known Chris for a little while, and I had no idea about how his journey had progressed. And Chris, I want to just tell you, I appreciate your transparency today, and our listeners, the message they're getting out there is kind of go for it, right?
Yeah, that's the only thing I could tell you is go for it and start ugly.
And that leads into your recent book.
Well, we talked about the movie, so just...
Yeah, let's stay in the movie.
Quick synopsis on the movie. You always want to look at the competitive landscape you're in and the advantages and disadvantages. So at the time, we created this thing called Podfest. And then there was another conference that really took hold, and they became the industry leader. We were, for lack of a better term, we were like the Pepsi to their Coke. So I was like, how could I differentiate to grow this? And I looked at these people that we had at one of the first Podfests. One guy talked about horses. The other guy was the first ever gaming podcast. We had a lady that was in the Keys that she had just left her life from South Carolina. So we made a documentary film about the medium of podcasting, and that helped our Pepsi, so to speak, our brand grow alongside the other brand. And it was really phenomenal. We got distribution out of L.A. Our distributor just now, they just went bankrupt or whatever. But luckily for me, it didn't really matter. I wanted eyeballs. I didn't care about the money. We got crowdfunded by the community 110%. And now it's the official documentary for the medium of podcasting. And we did that 3-4 years ago. And that really put me on the map for the podcasting space.
If somebody wanted to get that movie, is it available
anywhere? Yeah, we put it out free this past year on YouTube. So just look up The Messengers, a podcast documentary. I'm glad we did, because I didn't realize this, but our distributor was going belly up at the same time we were doing that. So it wasn't like I was going to make any more money on it.
So if you're a listener out there, again, it's on YouTube, correct?
YouTube, The Messengers, a podcast documentary. It's a full feature-length documentary, free of charge.
And I got to tell you, I saw it because I went to your premiere, and I've got to tell you, if you're an entrepreneur out there, even if you're not into podcasting, you need to see that movie.
It's a great message. It really is.
So now you've got Podfest, and you've kind of incubated that, and that's turned into a real, real deal.
Yeah, so I'm very fortunate. I own a piece of the sphere of influence of the medium of podcasting. What does that mean? That means we have a full-on trade show of the brands that represent these companies, and then we have education. This year we'll have over 10 tracks of learning going on at the same time with somewhere north of 2,000 attendees. So what we're doing now with Podfest is we're incubating different brands. We also own VidFest for YouTubers, and we're incubating different brands, so Military Creator Con, Audio Drama Con, and I know, Dean, you know this, but most people don't remember, like, audio dramas are like, what is that? Like, remember in history class when Orson Welles was doing War of the Worlds and everybody thought UFOs were attacking him? They're like, yeah. I go, that's an audio drama. I'm like, well, why did that disappear? You know, radio got so controlled and corporatized, it didn't allow for creativity. And now that creativity is open for everybody.
Yeah, you've had some podcasters that I met at your convention that are really
It blows your mind, yeah, of how big they are and how unique the niche is.
So you've decided to capture all this and really get the self-talker entrepreneur out there to get out of their own way with a recent publication that you authored.
Yeah, so we all have different words we say. I know you have yours. I have Start Ugly, and it seemed to resonate. And one thing you realize when you educate enough, when something resonates, you go back to the well. So it became my tagline, and my wife was an amazing support. I didn't know how to write the book or what I was going to write, and she's like, it'll come to you. You'll figure it out. And there's this little story that another friend of mine would talk about. The guy that had the lumberjack mill was replaced by the guy that created the chainsaw. So I took that seed of an idea and I created a mythical world of this very proud lumber mill owner who had an R&D lab. And then his young apprentice creates the bicycle chain that saws, that becomes the chainsaw. But he didn't see the future. So he fired the guy and gave him all rights to his bicycle chain that saws. So it's a very interesting parable, and it was based off of Who Moved My Cheese, in that it's very easily digestible, and for anyone that's looking for inspiration, it's a 30-minute read. I didn't realize this. I thought we would do well. We sold out our first printing in 80 hours, and I don't know that was possible because it's on-demand printing nowadays, but they only print, I guess, a certain amount. They already know how many people sell. So we're on our way to my goal, which is to sell 1 million copies to get the message out to as many people. It's meant for business owners and creatives alike.
Well, I think the message that I've gotten, and I know our listeners out there will get, is back to segment two. At the end of the day, your underlying mission that I've heard, and I've heard it with everything you've done, is truly helping people.
Yeah, so I figured out how to, well, if you ask most people what they want to do, because I've asked them, they all will say helping people. It's a threat in humanity, most people. Now, the question is, how are you going to do it? So I don't know why, but I figured that I knew I could build community. I knew I'm really good at connectivity, and I learned I'm really good at programming content. So I've been able to do that via conferences in a unique way that is unique, so much so that people all over the world seek me out for what I do, my platforms. So I think the question is, I call it standing in the silence. Stand in the silence of your own thoughts and figure out what it is you want to do. I think all too often we're bombarded by so much information and comparing ourselves to other people, we get lost in that noise instead of listening to our own intuition of what we want to do or what we were meant to do on this earth.
Well, do you think there's a challenge, and I run into this all the time, people have the greatest ideas in the world, but they never execute on it. They don't start ugly. It's got to be perfect. And do you run into that?
All the time. And you know why they come to you or I with those solutions? They're looking for permission to start.
Right.
And you and I are not the people to give permission, because there's no one giving you permission to start. One of my favorite things was this father and son started International Podcast Day. And I love saying to people, do you guys know who gave him permission to start that? And they all look at me like they start talking about governing body, blah, blah. I go, no, nobody. They gave themselves permission to do that. Most of these things that we see, everybody's like, I wonder how that happened. It was some guy or some gal came up with an idea, and she's like, I think I'm going to do this. And that's how it starts. And if you, as you know, if you explore any of these stories, it's someone with an idea figures it out, and then they put it out to the world, and then the world responds. But there's a lot of hard work in the process, step by step, but you got to start.
Well, there's a lot of hard work, but I jokingly talk to my entrepreneurs every time they're on the show about hard work. And I used to have a construction company with pipe layers that were 20 feet deep on an August day making minimum wage. I always thought that was hard work.
Yeah, that is hard work.
What we're doing and growing in entrepreneurship is thinking hard work, and there's a lot of hours, but you see the rewards, don't you?
I see the listen. Katie and I and my wife, we will be December 14th. We go to Arizona till January 5th. All my relatives on my wife's side, anyways, they all have to work. And what's interesting is every year they go through the same cycle. We say to them, hey, can we get together the day before Christmas? Or like, well, I got to work, you know, I got to work. And it's legitimate. But what they don't realize is I see this every year now. Whoever their boss is lets them off the day before. But I guess they don't realize it till the day before. Does this make sense?
Oh,
so
yeah.
I see it from a million miles away, knowing that they're going to be off the day before, because this happens every year.
Every year.
But they don't realize that this is the same pattern that happens. So just a unique... I don't think everybody should be entrepreneurs. I want to be very clear. I think everybody has a different risk tolerance of what they're comfortable with. But I do feel it's a blessing that I was given or developed the skills that lend well to entrepreneurship. And with that, yes, we have to work in different ways. But we get 3 weeks off, my wife and I, to be with our daughters and our family. And, you know, my relatives do get time off, but they have to ask for permission. And it's a different life choice that you make. So we trade off one thing for another, and we're both very grateful for it.
Well, you're an awesome entrepreneur. Is there any finishing message you would like our listeners to really take away today from your journey?
There's two. One is Just Start Ugly, and if you go juststartugly.com, you'll find the book. The other one is I grew up a mile away from the 26th president of the United States. His name was Theodore Roosevelt. And I would go to his gravestone at Young's Memorial, and I'd walk 26 steps up to his gravestone, and there was an inscription there, and it was, keep your feet on the ground and your eyes on the stars. So I had an artist paint this huge mural that's in my house. It takes up half a wall, but it's keep your feet on the ground, your eyes on the stars. And it's a grandfather with a grandson pointing up at the stars. And I think if you do that in life, you could achieve anything you want.
Wow, Chris. I mean, I really appreciate you coming on today. I appreciate you sharing your journey. And for all our listeners out there, if you haven't read the book Start Ugly, you've definitely got to go on Amazon. I ordered it myself, and I'm really excited. I've read half of it, and it's an easy read. That's a quick read. So I'm really happy about that. If you're a podcaster out there, just start or want to be a podcaster, start today. Look up podfest.com, I guess, or Podfest. You'll find it. It's all over the internet. It's one of the greatest events if you're a wannabe podcaster or a podcaster to attend. And again, if you have any questions or thoughts or help you need, you can reach out at help@adjunctco.com. Our listeners reach out every week. We've got folks that will reach back. It might be Chris if it's up on podcasting or something. And again, we're here for you every week, bringing you top CEOs and entrepreneurs. So I just want to remind you that I'm Dean Akers, your host for the CEO Hour, bringing you top producers. Chris, thanks again for coming on today.
Thanks for having me, Dean.
And we'll see all of you next week. I'll have Mayor Bob Buckhorn on, so we'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening to the CEO Hour with Dean Akers, helping businesses and CEOs succeed in today's marketplace. Receive a free CEO physical when you connect with Dean at deanakers.com. That's deanakers.com. And join us again next week for the CEO Hour with Dean Akers.